Grab a hymnal, turn to page 599, and let's sing Break Thou the Bread of Life. Hymn number 599.
Amen. Welcome your neighbor in the name of the Lord this morning. As you make your way back to your seats, if you'll turn over on the back of your bulletin. Do have a few announcements to make this morning. First of all, a reminder that we'll be having an Ash Wednesday service this Wednesday, February 10th. We'll do that in the chapel at 6 o'clock. That means we won't be having our pastor's Bible study this week, but we'll do the Ash Wednesday service instead. It's a fairly short service, so if you want to come and be a part of that as we begin the season of Lent, that's 6 o'clock on Wednesday, February 10th. I was also asked to announce that there's going to be a Valentine's Day donation lunch next Sunday at the school cafeteria. It's going to be put on by the junior class, and they're going to be raising funds to help defray prom expenses. We had originally planned to have a fellowship lunch here at the church, but since we heard about this, we want to support the junior class, so we're going to ask that you go and take part in that meal instead next Sunday on Valentine's Day. So make plans to attend that. Also, just want to announce any of you that have youth or grandkids in youth or anything like that, we were going to have a Super Bowl party at my house today, but Briley has been diagnosed with the flu and strep throat, and Hannah started running fever yesterday, so there's not going to be youth group tonight. The flu's pretty much decimated the elementary school and everything, and so we just want to kind of keep everybody home and stay well. I love you guys very much, but I'm not going to shake your hands this morning, and I'm not going to, because I don't want to expose you to any of that as well, and I'm going to have some helpers serving communion today as well, so we don't want to expose you to that sickness at all, even though I don't feel it yet. Just want to be careful, all right? So that's one of our things we need to be in prayer for, definitely, this week, is all the kiddos and people who are coming down with illnesses in our community. But before we get to more prayer requests, what about joys? Huh? It's a joy to see the Stams here with us this morning. We're so glad to have y'all back with us, and been following you guys on Facebook. Looks like y'all are having a good time up in Colorado, but we're glad you came back home for a visit. Any other joys this morning? What are we happy about today? Okay, Depot Library Tuesday, 11 o'clock, Fat Tuesday lunch with some gumbo. Sounds like a good deal. All right, so come down there and support them. Any other joys this morning?
We celebrated Isabella's third birthday at primetime at Abilene
last night. Oh, boy. I bet that was fun. Was it fun for y'all, too? Yeah. I've been to Primetime. That's a pretty loud place. That's a pretty fun place. Oh, Brian said he bet Robert didn't want to leave. He just wanted to stay there all night. Any other joys this morning? In Graham today, is that right? Yeah, that's Betsy told me they were going to be over in Graham to aunt. So Harold's aunt and Jody's. Okay, so they're celebrating her 95th birthday today. So that's a joy. That's a big crowd. That's a big crowd. Wonderful. That's a joy. That's right. What else? Is anything else this morning? All right. Well, let's take a moment and look at your prayer list today. We do have an update here from out at Elbert. Karen told me an update on Larry Holder. If any of you know Larry, he was diagnosed with cancer a while back. And they did a PET scan this week, and that cancer has spread to his bones. And so they are not going to be doing any more treatments for Larry. So we're just prayers for that family as they go through this time in their family. Are there any other updates or additions to our prayer list? Yes, sir. Your papa.
Jim Millsap.
Okay.
He's at home now. Okay. Good,
okay. Well, we'll add him to the list and be praying for him. You bet. Any others this morning? Yes, sir. Okay. Pray for Sarah and Taylor right now. Yes, sir. Babe Portwood died unexpectedly. That service is today, I believe, at 2:00 in Seymour. Any others? Yes, sir.
Jess Stewart's father-in-law passed away. His name is Roland Mason.
Roland Mason. And that's Jess Stewart's father-in-law? Okay. We'll be in prayer for that family. Any others this morning? All right. Well, let's prepare our hearts to go to the Lord in prayer today. Let's pray. God, we come into your house and we're just so thankful that we can gather on a beautiful morning like this and fellowship with each other, sing praises to you and hear your word. And so we pray, Lord, that you would open our hearts to receive that word today. May it be a word that would challenge us, renew us, give us a boldness to leave this place and be your disciples to the world around us. We thank you for the joys that have been lifted up. We give you thanks and praise for all of the blessings in our lives, for friends, for family, for just the little things that we take for granted so often, Lord, food on our tables, a roof over our heads, jobs to provide for our families. We thank you for those. Lord, we lift up these that have been named on our prayer list this morning. We pray for the Holder family, that you would just give them your peace, that you would just ease Larry's pain, and that you would just be around his family and surround them with your love this day. We pray for Jim Millsap as he recovers. We ask that you would just touch his heart in a strong way and make it strong again. We lift up Sarah and Taylor to you, Lord. We just lift that whole family up. We pray your blessing upon them, and we just pray your peace with them. We pray for the Portwood family and the Mason family this morning as they have suffered losses in their families. We pray that you would just give them your peace and comfort and help us to reach out to them and share our love with them as well as they grieve the loss of their loved ones. And we pray for all of these on our list today. Be with each person in the way that they need you the most right now. We pray for our community. We're thankful that we can live in the little community of Throckmorton. We love and care for each other, and we just pray for those this morning who may not know what it means to have a relationship with you. Help us through our actions to be a light and a witness to those around us. We pray for our nation. We pray that you would raise up godly men and women who would stand firm on the truth of your word, not be pulled to and fro as the culture seems to dictate, but would be firm in their beliefs. That you would give them wisdom. And Lord, we pray for our world. We pray for those people who have no homes to go to this morning because of terrorism and war. We pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ this morning who can't come peacefully into a place like this to worship, but who have to worship in secret for fear that they might be arrested or even killed for their faith. We pray your protection over them. We pray your deliverance. We pray for peace. We pray for those men and women who are serving in our armed forces this day, especially those who are in dangerous places this morning. We pray that you would keep them safe, that you would guide their leaders to keep them out of harm's way, and that you would just give their families your peace as they anxiously await their return. And God, when we come to those times when we don't know what to say or even how to pray, help us remember we can always pray with confidence the prayer you taught your disciples when you prayed, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen." We can have some ushers gather at the back to take up our morning offering. Let us pray. God, we ask that you would bless this offering that we give. May we give with cheerful hearts. May these funds be used for your glory here in Throckmorton and around the world. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thank you. You'll notice in your bulletin there's several scripture passages there, and we'll get to those in a little bit. The first one, though, we're going to read is from 2 Corinthians 4, verses 7 through 18. And as before we get into this passage, I was just reminded this week as we're getting ready to start Lent, this season of time before Easter Sunday, which is the most joyous celebration of the Christian year. You know, a lot of people outside the church really think that's Christmas, but for the Christian, it's the resurrection. Because Paul says, without the resurrection, our faith is for nothing. If Jesus didn't rise from the dead, then what point is there to having faith in him? And so while his birthday is fun, and we have a great time celebrating his birthday, his resurrection is the pinnacle of the Christian faith. It's what we hang our faith on, is that resurrection. And so as we're preparing to go into that season of Lent, I was thinking about how oftentimes we in our culture today have a hard time, we confuse joy and happiness. And we think that they're one and the same, when they're actually not. And so as we begin reading this scripture this morning, we're hearing from a man named Paul, who wrote quite a bit of the New Testament. And he wrote quite a bit of the New Testament while he was being persecuted for his faith, oftentimes writing from a prison cell. He was beaten for his faith. He was stoned for his faith. He was put in prison more than once because of his outspoken faith in Christ. And yet he has the ability to write something like this. And just listen to the tone of his voice and what he's saying here. And it's kind of hard for us sometimes to think, if I'm going through some of the stuff that he's gone through, how I could really feel this way. And he's talking to the Corinthians. He's trying to encourage them and give them hope in knowing that, you know, you're not always going to have it easy, but even when you're having it tough, you can still have joy. You can still have hope in your faith. And he begins in verse 7. He says, "But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us." That little phrase, jars of clay, he's just talking about our physical bodies, that they're temporary. You know, we don't depend on our own strength for our joy. We don't depend on our own capabilities for our joy. And this treasure that's within us, because we are temporary, because we are jars of clay, we understand that this comes from God and not from us. That's what he's saying there. In verse 8, he says, "We are hard pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. For we who are alive are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that his life may also be revealed in our mortal body. So then, death is at work in us, but life is at work in you. It is written, 'I believed, therefore I have spoken.' Since we have that same spirit of faith, we also believe and therefore speak, because we know that the one who raised the Lord Jesus from the dead will also raise us with Jesus and present us with you to himself. All this is for your benefit, so that the grace that is reaching more and more people may cause thanksgiving to overflow to the glory of God. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we're wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Happiness. We see it all the time. People are constantly in pursuit of happiness. I want to be happy. What can I have that makes me happy? Our whole culture is centered around this pursuit You know, everything you watch on TV, every advertisement, you know, whether it's for the next diet craze all the way to the newest car, the next iPhone, or it's, you know, if you have this, if you do this, you're going to be more happy. Now, I'm not knocking happy, okay? I like happy. Everybody likes happy. But is it possible for you to always be happy? You know, the culture likes to make you think that that's a possibility, so it just keeps pushing more and more stuff, more and more things. If you just get this, you'll be happy. If you'll have that, you'll be happy. But we all know deep down inside that that's not true. Because it doesn't matter if you have the latest car. There's going to be another one come out next year. It's going to be better. If you have the nicest house in town, sooner or later somebody's going to build a nicer one. If you have the latest gadgets, if you have that Romeo or that Juliet in your life, you know, at some point they're going to let you down because people are imperfect. You know, we can't ever truly be happy all the time. Why? Why is that? If we look in the scriptures, just like we have the word happy and joy, they had different words too in the scriptures. And the word for happy or happiness is a Greek word called makarios. M-A-K-A-R-I-O-S. Makarios. And that word in the Greek refers to the freedom of the rich from normal cares and worries. It's a word used to describe a person who has received some form of good fortune, money, health, family, children, that sort of thing. And that is the word there where we get happiness from. But you see, happy is tied to our emotions. It's driven by our circumstances. New car, happy. Get a raise at work, happy. Get a date with that pretty girl or that handsome guy, happy. Find out the car is really a piece of junk, not happy. Find out the raise means double the hours, not happy. Find out that guy or that girl's really a jerk, not happy. It's all centered around our circumstance. It can come, it can go, up and down, up and down. You can't always be happy. Happiness is also centered around us having total control of our lives. We constantly are seeking to arrange circumstances so that happiness will be extended for as long as possible. It's about us being in control and wanting to make things happen so that we'll be happy longer, which ultimately becomes kind of a self-centered way of living. And you'll see people oftentimes in the pursuit of their own happiness stepping on other people and knocking other people down and trying to climb that ladder and trying to be on top all the time so that they're happy, but other people end up suffering in their pursuit of happiness. Joy is a completely different story. Joy comes from the word chara, C-H-A-R-A. One of the other words in Greek from that same root is charis, C-H-A-R-I-S, and that's the word we get grace from, or thanks. It's also the word that we get character from, or charisma. In short, it means it is of God. It comes to us from outside of ourselves. It is not conditioned upon our circumstances in the moment. And they say that the opposite of joy is not sadness. It's fear. It's fear. Joy is a fruit of the Spirit. It comes from God. And that's why people like Paul could write some of the things he did while he's constantly being persecuted for his faith. I don't think Paul was probably very happy when he got stoned for his faith. He probably wasn't very happy when he got thrown in prison for his faith. But yet he can constantly say, our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. Had joy. It is entirely possible to have joy and not be happy. That's foreign to us. It's hard for us to get, because we like to make both of those mean the same thing. But I hope you can see the difference. There's a quote from a nun who wrote this in a convent one time. She says, if you really want serenity in life, don't pursue happiness, because anything you get happiness from will not last. No matter what it is, it will end up disappointing you. The only way to get serenity is to stop pursuing happiness and start pursuing joy. It's an interesting way to look at it. If you think about it, it's true. You know? And I know that's hard to believe, because sometimes we think, well, there's certain things in my life that always make me happy. You know, we like to think that nobody's going to disappoint us. But if all of your happiness is wrapped up in your job, then at some point that's going to let you down. All right, because you're not going to get the promotion, or you're not going to get the raise, or you're going to get laid off, or something's going to happen. And if your whole life is wrapped up in that, that's pretty tough. If your whole identity is wrapped up in a relationship with another person, and that person is everything to you, and that, you know, without them you're nothing, guess what? Man, you've put a lot of pressure on that other person, haven't you? Can they always be perfect? Can they always do everything right? No, they're a human being. They're going to say something that's going to let you down. They're going to do something or forget to do something. There's going to be times when they will disappoint you. Happiness is temporary. Joy is eternal. And I see, it's hard for us to experience joy. I think sometimes the more we have, and the more we're caught up in material things and the ways of our culture, the harder it is for us to truly experience joy, because we do tie so much of our life up into outside things. And I really didn't learn that and really understand that until I took my first youth group mission trip when we went to Mexico. And I don't know if I've shared this story with you or not, but that first trip down there, we were going to do a vacation Bible school at this little church. It's a little village about 50 miles inside Mexico, over the border, up in the mountains, this little bitty village, probably just a little bit bigger than Throckmorton, not much, this little town. And one of the things we were going to do is we were going to help this man put a roof on his house. Now, this young man, he was in his 20s. He had just gotten married to his childhood sweetheart. It was the cutest thing in the world. They were just this lovely young couple. They were so happy. They were so in love. And he, in providing for his wife, he built their house by hand himself. And he was so proud of it. He was so proud of it. And that house was maybe the width of this section of pews, possibly. Back to about maybe where Sharon and Trav are sitting back there. That's about the size of this house. He built it completely out of adobe brick. Two room house, and we were going to put a roof on it for him. And it was really tempting for us to feel sorry for them because of their poverty, because of all the things they didn't have. Here we are coming from Midland, where they had everything. You know, during the oil boom, everybody had everything, you know. And we come to this little village in Mexico, but you should have heard when the locals came to help us do the work, and they were helping us put the roof on this house. They were singing. They were happy. They were joyous all the time. They had no idea what they didn't have. They had no clue. But they had this sense about them, this joy about them, and the children. The children that came to the Bible school, some of them didn't even have shoes. But they were joyous. It wasn't happiness, it was a joy. They were laughing and singing and praising God. And I guarantee you, our kids left there more blessed than any kind of blessing we might have left behind to them because we really got a sense of what it means to be joyous. To be joyous. And that brings me to my point today. You know, as we go into this season of Lent, I want to ask you a question. Do you have the joy of the Lord in your life? Or have you been confusing joy with happiness? And in your pursuit, your constant pursuit of happiness, has it left you wanting? Has it left you needing more? And maybe this morning you need to say, you know what, I've been getting that all mixed up. And I need to quit worrying about stuff and relationships and all these things that I think are going to make me happy. And I just need to be asking the Lord for His joy. Because see, the joy of the Lord is a gift from Him. The little kids will tell you it's one of the fruits of the Spirit. I wish we had more kids here this Sunday. I was going to ask them to yell out the fruits of the Spirit for us this morning, but there's not that many of them here. But they know that joy is one of those fruits. It's a gift from God. I can't manufacture it. I can't produce it myself. It comes from God. Here are a few more verses from the Bible about this, about joy. Proverbs 10:28. The prospect of the righteous is joy, but the hopes of the wicked come to nothing. 1 Peter 1:8-9. Though you have not seen Him, you love Him. And even though you do not see Him now, you believe in Him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the end result of your faith, which is the salvation of your souls. Romans 15:13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And then finally, Psalm 30:5. For His anger is but for a moment. His favor is for a lifetime. Weeping may linger for the night, but joy comes with the morning. Do you have the joy of the Lord? You know, as we enter in this season of Lent, a lot of people, you know, you hear, do you really know what that is? Do you know what that means? You know, people say, well, what are you giving up for Lent? And, you know, Lent, just for FYI, it's a season of 40 days. Not counting Sundays, which begins on Wednesday, Ash Wednesday, and ends on the Saturday before Easter Sunday. The 40 days represent the time Jesus spent in the wilderness, enduring the temptation of Satan and preparing to begin His ministry. Lent is a time of repentance, fasting, and preparation for the coming of Easter. It's a time of self-examination and reflection. In the early church, Lent was a time to prepare new converts for baptism. Today, Christians focus on their relationship with God, often choosing to give up something or to volunteer and give of themselves for others. Sundays in Lent are not counted in the 40 days because each Sunday represents a mini Easter. And the reverent spirit of Lent is tempered with joyful anticipation of the resurrection. You know, so as we enter into this time, if you're in the habit of working through Lent, maybe a Bible study, maybe you do give up something during the season of Lent, go ahead and continue to do that in your life. If you've never done anything for Lent, I want to encourage you to do so. But if you do, I also want you to think about praying to God and asking Him for His joy. Ask Him for His joy. I need to know what it means to have the joy of the Lord in my life. Because folks, circumstances are going to change. There's always going to be drama. There's always going to be something come up that takes away our happiness. But if you have the joy of the Lord, you can continue to rejoice in Him, even through those circumstances. You know, we read in the Bible when Paul and them were in prison, they sang hymns. They sang hymns of praise to the Lord, even while they were in prison. And you know what? They led the prison guards to faith through their joy. Their circumstances did not determine whether or not they were joyful or not, because joy had nothing to do with their circumstances. So as you come to the table of the Lord this morning, may this be a time when you do an examination of yourself and you ask yourself, do I have that? And if not, seek it. Pray for it. Begin to ask God to give it to you. And He will give it to you if you seek it from Him. Let's pray. God, we thank You for this time when we begin preparing for Your resurrection. And during this time of Lent, we seek to look deep within ourselves and we ask, where am I lacking in my faith? What's keeping me from truly being the best disciple I can be for You? And perhaps for some this morning, it's just this confusion between joy and happiness. Maybe I've just been putting all of my effort, all of my time, all of my energy into things that are going to make me happy, thinking that that's also joy, when in reality, it has nothing to do with joy. So as we come to the table this morning, may we change our direction. May we understand that joy can't come from anything we do. It comes from You. You are the giver of joy. And may we seek it with all our hearts. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You can find the liturgy for communion in your hymnals on page 12, or you can follow along on the screen. Hear the invitation. Christ our Lord invites to His table all who love Him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved You with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done Your will. We have broken Your law. We have rebelled against Your love. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. The Great Thanksgiving is found on page 13. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right
to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to You, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with Your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise Your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of Your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are You and blessed is Your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of His suffering, death, and resurrection, You gave birth to Your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water in the Spirit. On the night in which He gave Himself up for us, He took bread, gave thanks to You, broke the bread, gave it to His disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is My body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." When the supper was over, He took the cup, gave thanks to You, gave it to His disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is My blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of Me." And so, in remembrance of these, Your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Would those who are assisting please come forward at this time. We'll be taking communion by intinction this morning. Brian and Geneva will serve you. And after you've taken the elements, you may stay at the altar if you'd like and pray. The table has been prepared. Come as you feel led. Thank you.
Our last song in the service is going to be a worship song. Words will be up on the screen. If you'll stand and join me in singing, Trading My Sorrows. Please rise.
Persecuted, not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. I am blessed beyond the curse, for His promise will endure, that His joy is gonna be my strength. For sorrow may last for the night, His joy comes with the morning. Yeah, I'm trading my sorrow, I'm trading my shame.
Receive this benediction. May the Lord Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit and to the honor and glory of God the Father, bless you and keep you and shower you with His joy. And may you seek it with all of your heart. Amen.